We all know the classic prehistoric battle of T-Rex versus Triceratops, the ultimate terrestrial carnivore against the freakishly agile sword tank. That's a fight that's dominated the public perception of dinosaurs for over 100 years, and for good reason. But what if I told you that Triceratops wasn't the biggest herbivore that T-Rex came into conflict with? Well, that is what I'm telling you right now. So let's talk about it. Edmontosaurus annectens was a species of hadrosaurid that lived in the late Cretaceous of North America, with the closely related Edmontosaurus regalis only being known from Canada. E. annectens is found in Canada as well as the north-central United States. They were also incredibly successful animals, with thousands of disarticulated specimens known from the Ruth Mason Quarry in South Dakota. They were numerous, certainly, but their high population didn't stop them from growing to be the size of elephants. A 2022 study found that an average fully grown Edmontosaurus annectens would have weighed between 5 and 6 tons and would be 11 to 12 meters long, using a sample size of over 600 individuals. Of course, the maximum size is much larger, as you likely inferred from the title of this video. Two record-breaking specimens are known that are probably Edmontosaurus annectens, although if they turn out to be something different, they'd still be the biggest hadrosaurids known from North America by quite a bit. X-Rex, or MOR-1142, is an enormous 7.5-meter tail that would scale to a 14.3-meter, 13-plus-ton behemoth. The other specimen is a maxilla known as Becky's Giant that would result in a broadly similar range, although the material is much worse. So we go from average African bush elephant size to bigger than a Columbian mammoth, with not a lot of specimens in between. Odd. That's the taphonomic mess that is the fossil record, I suppose. Part of the secret to Edmontosaurus's success, both in population density and potential body size, was its teeth. They had hundreds of teeth at a time that grew in columns, forming leaf-shaped structures perfect for slicing and crushing plant matter in huge quantities. This shovel-it-down chewing approach enabled them to eat efficiently, so they could attain large sizes without sacrificing speed for fermentation chambers like sauropods. And they weren't just huge animals either, they were also likely fast-footed. Biomechanical analyses from 2007 and 2011 indicated that adults could gallop at a brisk 45 kilometers an hour or 28 miles an hour, with subadults really booking it at up to 57 kilometers or 35 miles an hour. It wouldn't surprise me if they were faster than that in life, given how biomechanical simulations are limited to preserved material. Any soft tissue structures that may have allowed for higher sustained speeds wouldn't be included. Going off these simulations, the fast-paced herbivore likely would have been able to outrun the giant predator of its ecosystem, adult Tyrannosaurus, fairly easily in a straight-up race. Unless T-Rex itself was faster than we thought, which is pretty likely. Biomechanical models by nature can only express a portion of an animal's anatomy, as demonstrated by this rhinoceros totally eating it when charging. Models would indicate that the animal's bones should have shattered, but it was completely fine. That's why I'm a little skeptical of studies that claim T-Rex running speeds were limited to barely being faster than a sprinting human because of the risk of breaking its bones by moving too quickly. At any rate, Edmontosaurus was probably faster than an adult Rex, and we do have strong evidence of the hadrosaurid having escaped being hunted by the tyrant lizard king. A caudal vertebra was found with a T-Rex tooth embedded in it, and the bite had partially healed over before the animal died. This individual, at least, was attacked from behind or the side and was fast enough to make its escape. Lucky guy. Another Edmontosaurus appeared to have been lightly nipped on the tail, damaging the neural arches of its caudal verts in a half-moon shape that plausibly matches a Rex biting on it from above. The damage was partially healed. And here's some anecdotal information I found interesting that I learned when my wife and I went on a Hell Creek dig with Bucky Derflinger, the guy who discovered cope. He told us that most of the Edmonto specimens found in the area consisted of just the tails, implying that T-Rex preferred to feed on the pelvis upward since there was more meat there. Thought that was interesting. And speaking of cope, Rex, and Edmontosaurus, on that trip we actually found the articulated tail of a subadult or small adult Edmonto. It was at the cope site in the lower horizon and looked like it had been exposed for quite some time. Thankfully, the verts were mostly covered in an iron concretion that helped them resist weathering.
If this material really turns out to be any good, I'm going to name it Blister, because, yeah.
We named it Blister. Originally, when we were prospecting at the cope site, we thought it was a big weathered femur since the concretions formed the exact shape of an Edmonto femoral head. Upon closer inspection, it turned out to be an articulated tail along with fragments of potential limb bone and pelvis. Over the next 2 days, we uncovered more caudals, removing the overburden with pickaxes and shovels, digging through the iron concretion with screwdrivers and knives, and finding a point in the tail where the caudal vertebrae ended before resuming several inches later at a different angle in the iron concretion layer. We took measurements that indicated the exposed portion of the tail was about 8 feet long, which would correspond to a 9 to 10 meter animal. That's fairly small for an Edmontosaurus, so Blister may have been a subadult. We covered the bones with tinfoil and overburden to protect it until the next dig season, so hopefully next year we'll be more prepared to safely excavate the entire tail.
Well, let's have a funeral service now.
Isaac,
here lies Blister. 66 MYA to 66 MYA. Soon to be uncovered again in the next dig season. Do we have any final words for the recently, well, not so recently deceased? Should have picked a better place to die. Very pithy, I like it. What about you, Bucky?
He should have brought some friends.
He should have brought some friends.
More friends.
All right, so Blister's legacy is not doing enough or being enough.
So while Blister was far from the biggest animal that T-Rex ever hunted, big Edmontos may very well have taken the title. That doesn't mean that they were defenseless prey animals that would just roll over and die, though. Obviously, they weren't competing with T-Rex when it comes to weaponry, and on average, they seem to have been 2 or 3 tons lighter, but they could still have bitten with their powerful beaks or kicked like an elephant-sized horse. The little fossil evidence that we have of their interactions, however, seems to show injuries to the tail during an escape. That would indicate that they were most likely to flee rather than fight, which, you know, against a T-Rex, that's a pretty smart decision, especially if you are in fact the faster runner. Ambush tactics and hunting at night would have been the best way for a Rex to take down an Edmontosaurus in order to counter the speed difference. And in order to hunt a beast like X-Rex, which is several tons heavier than the biggest T-Rex specimens found to date, cooperative hunting may have been needed in order to increase likelihood of success, at least for small Rexes. A fully grown adult may have been able to take it on alone, given the Rex's ridiculous weaponry. The only Rexes we know to be skeletally mature are Cope, Sue, Scotty, Trix, and G-Rex, implying a fully grown adult average mass of well over 10 tons. That would only be a 40% difference in mass, which is a far smaller predator-to-prey ratio than we see in the interactions between modern Komodo dragons and water buffalo. And while a big theropod's bite would certainly be septic, T-Rex's raw physical bite alone could permanently damage bone even of an Edmontosaurus that escaped a hunt. We've seen the evidence of that quite clearly. Although, maybe even the giant hadrosaurs of Hell Creek wouldn't have been the biggest animals that T-Rex ever hunted if it turned out that Alamosaurus was on the menu. This North American titanosaur didn't live in Hell Creek at all, as far as we know, but coexisted with Rex in the North Horn, Black Peaks, Javelina, and Ojo Alamo formations. There is a significant possibility that the remains referred to Alamosaurus across these formations actually belong to multiple species or even genera, but with that currently a muddy topic, we'll refer to them as Alamosaurus for now. This titanosaur was big, with the largest specimens at nearly 40 metric tons. Adults would have been able to kick or stomp on potential predators, not to mention the devastating force of a tail slap. That would be a tough ask for any lone theropod to hunt, even the 11 to 12 plus ton individuals like Cope and Sue. However, we do have Alamosaurus material, or at least Maastrichtian North American titanosaur material, with tyrannosaurid feeding traces on it. Whether or not that was due to a hunt or a scavenging event is unclear, but the idea of T-Rex at least consuming big sauropods is now supported by fossil evidence. Anecdotally, the T-Rexes found in areas with high hadrosaurid density seem to be bigger and more robust, especially in the lower Hell Creek. Bucky's hypothesis, which does make sense to me, is that the Rexes that hunted Edmontosaurus had an easier and safer time of it during hunts, that allowed them more consistent, easier access to large amounts of food, making it easier for them to grow bigger. The Rexes found in Triceratops-dominated areas are smaller and more gracile, since that would help them in terms of agility and speed against the heavily defended, fast-turning Ceratopsians. This hasn't been studied or statistically verified, but I certainly think it's an interesting possibility. The Rexes found around Faith, South Dakota seem to be, built different, in particular. You've got Sue and Cope, which are neck and neck at the moment for the biggest Rex, given how Sue's measurements were underreported in the literature. Bucky was a 16-year-old Rex who was already incredibly robust, with a ribcage nearly as big as Stan's. Victoria was also a robust individual at 17 years of age, and with several more years of active growth to go, was already comparable in size to the Giganotosaurus holotype, if not slightly larger. The biogeographically constrained body mass of Tyrannosaurus is a phenomenon that might be worth some in-depth statistical study to verify.
I wonder if this is how the dwarves felt digging up Moria. I don't know about you, but I would definitely delve too greedily and too deep if it meant finding more good Cope material.
Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this dig-inspired video on Edmontosaurus. I've got a few video ideas based on the adventures we had during our week in South Dakota, including a Nanotyrannus piece, so subscribe to stay updated on all this fun science. You can check out my book, Obsidian Dawn, which is now on sale on Amazon, Ingram Spark, and Kobo. Feel free to join the channel for loyalty badges and shoutouts, including early access to videos at the Megatheropod level, if you're hardcore, that is. I'm the Vividen, and I'll see you the next time I hijack a video to talk about Tyrannosaurus.